Hello friends, today I would like to talk about perfectionism, or as I'd like to call it, perfectionalism, as perfectionism and professionalism combined, because for certain professions these two terms are so jointly blended together that really one cannot exist without the other. As artists, we all have great sense of perfectionism. In a way, it's impossible to go into the arts as a profession if you don't have it. Artist is someone who spends hours, days, months, weeks just perfecting a musical phrase or searching for just the perfect ending of the poem or translating a line to another language and just searching for just the right expression. Perfectionism is so much engraved in our training, in our very existence, and it's a great driving force, because one of the beauty of living life as an artist is that you never reach it. It's perfectionism is a line. It's like a line of horizon. You search for it, you come as close as you can, but it always escapes you. It always moves away. There are other possibilities, there are other ways to interpret a musical line, there are constant different shifting ways of creative thinking. So we think, oh, we got it, that now we know everything there is to know, now we are truly professionals, and I will serve the word professionalism for another video. That's the moment when we feel this total being totally sure about reaching some kind of summit. It's a very clear indication that you go down from there on, because we never stay in one place, regardless of what level you are on, whether you are just starting, whether you're a student, whether you're a professional, whether you are a star, it doesn't matter. Our level never stays the same, and perhaps only artist can actually know or be aware of the fluctuations in the level, but it never stays the same. We constantly change, and we either grow or we shrink in our abilities. It's just as simple as that. The moment we stop developing, the moment we stop constantly studying, practicing, searching, failing, that's the moment we stop growing and start going the other way. It doesn't stay still. Of course, you maintain certain level, and it's a comforting thought, could be, but generally speaking, you're constantly shifting. So it's perfectionism is this wonderful, unattainable sense of beauty. Now I use this word carefully, but it's this perfect sense, glimpse, glimpsing the sun, but not staring at it directly because it makes you blind. And it's something that motivates you to keep on searching, to keep on going, to keep on working on yourself. Now, perfectionism can also be very deadly. And there is something deadly about the concept, because perfection is something that theoretically doesn't need to be changed. Now, death can be said is perfect. Life is not. Life is messy. And I would much rather stay alive than be dead. And perfectionism is capable, actually, paradoxically, of killing your creativity and killing your motivation and stopping you on your tracks. And it can be your best friend, but it's in more cases than not can be your greatest enemy. Now, perfectionism comes, it sends a representative, and I call this representative your inner critic. Now, what is your inner critic? Your inner critic is this voice inside of you that believes it knows it's all, it has seen it's all. Of course it doesn't, but its attitude that it does, and it's has not such a great opinion of you most of the time. It's this sense of judgment on anything you do. And your inner critic is very important, actually. And again, your inner critic can be your greatest advisor and your best friend, but it can also be your greatest enemy. So this is a very important relationship in your life. Now, I want to make it clear that inner critic is you. It's not some outside force. It's not like your trusted friend or professor or whoever. But it's this voice within you, part of your intuition, perhaps, or part of your psychological makeup, maybe your self-doubt, it's so I just want to make clear that we are talking about just another side of you that lives within you and not outside. So now, how to build this relationship so it actually becomes a very important and positive force in what you do, in your art, and I suppose it can be translated to other professions, other situations. It's just for artists, it is a matter of life or death. And I especially address it to the writing folks. So if you're a composer or if you are a writer, more so than those who are in the interpretive side of arts, although some of it can be translated there as well. But if you're a writer, you create something out of nothing, and you either can do it or not. And also, how is the final result is a big question. So, and it becomes very important, how do you form and control this relationship with your own private inner critic? And here, where I would say that timing is everything. At the beginning, let's say you have an idea, and let me use, music, for example. You have an idea for a string quartet, let's say. And it's like an abstract idea. You have a feeling that, a feeling of it, and you're really excited about it, and you think that's really something that is passionately burning within you, and you should do it. So at the very beginning, just as you sort of meditate on this idea, the worst, absolutely the worst thing you can do is to let your inner critic speak. Now, at this point, I wouldn't say you need to murder your inner critic, because you will need him later on. So don't murder him. But give him some sleeping pills, let him hibernate so that you don't hear your inner critic at this stage. There is nothing can be more destructive and murderous than your sense of judgment at this very fragile, very sensitive point in your creation. Now, you may think that you're so clever and you know how to put your inner critic asleep, but the thing with inner critic, that as any critic, it likes to be heard. And it's very clever how to make himself to be heard by you. So you're going to start, or you may start having certain thoughts. For example, and let's say you already, you start in sketching your idea, and you may start thinking, would this string quartet players like this work or like what they have in mind? Maybe there is nothing that I'm writing that is virtuosic to let them showcase their talents and their wonderful virtuosity. Or maybe you're thinking, well, I actually wrote, this will be way too complicated, it will take too many rehearsals, it will annoy them. Maybe you are thinking, well, here I have this whole movement that needs to be played with overpressed bow, and it's really disturbing, and the audience will hate it. Or, oh my goodness, the critics will think this is too traditional, too tonal. The critics will destroy it. Or you might be thinking, well, what would my professor from my school, whom I respect so much, would think about this piece I'm writing? Or you may be thinking what your aunt may think about it. Or you might be thinking, well, you know, great late quartets of Beethoven and so much history with the quartet writing, so many wonderful quartets and Mozart and Haydn and Bartok and Shostakovich and Auerbach-Hastein quartets. So why should I even, you know, try to write a string quartet at this point? Do I really have something new to say to the forum, to contribute something valuable, lasting, memorable? Now, so if you are thinking any of the thoughts or any variations of the thoughts or any variations on variations of the thoughts, because we are all different and we have different worrisome thoughts. Now, I guarantee you it's full recipe for disaster and failure. So, and it is messages from your inner critic. So why now? You may think, okay, what's so wrong with imagining my professor from school, whom I respect so much, listening to this piece and thinking and perhaps imagining already what kind of response I may get. Why is it so dangerous? Why is it so destructive and so on? And what's destructive about it is that all of these thoughts are extremely selfish. They have nothing to do with the music. They have nothing to do with the art form. They have nothing to do with this idea that you had. All of them have something to do with your ego. And at the moment when you are just starting going towards your idea, it has to be very pure. It has to be very idealistic. It cannot be about you. It has to be about music. Why is it about you? Because all you are worried about is how all these people will react to you, what kind of judgment they will pass on you. Again, this is the worst thing you can do, and pretty much guaranteed to destroy this very fragile idea that is still like a child to be forming. So you have to really remove your ego, you have to remove your inner critic, you have to silence him completely at this stage and keep it very, very pure. Now, how do you go about writing it? So what I recommend, and it's both for music and literature, is actually to do your first sketch. It can be very, very rough sketch of the work, to do it by hand, and to do it as quickly as possible. Now, of course, if you're working on the symphony or if you're working on a novel, this as quickly as possible is not going to be a few hours, and it may not be even a few weeks. But the idea is to get through the first complete sketch as quickly as you can, with holes, with gaps, with not working out details, not knowing precisely how, I don't know, you're going to connect the sections or how you're going to orchestrate certain part or what. So bypassing details, but building a skeleton of a work. And do it while you are inspired, while you're burning hot with this, and just get the skeleton done. The moment you have your skeleton, from the beginning to the end, with some gaps and so on, that's the moment when you can congratulate yourself that you got there, and you can actually start working. Now, at that moment, you very gently wake up your inner critic, because now you have to have your analytical brain working. And another thing that I find very important, and I must say it here, with this initial first sketch, because I'm always asked, well, how do you get through this first sketch quickly? And what's very important is not to have any expectations for this work. You should give yourself permission to completely fail. Tell yourself that you will complete this sketch and it will go directly to the garbage can, because it's just not something that you're ever going to use. Really put distance from yourself. Remove any pressure from yourself from this sketch. So, and I find this psychological release very important, actually, to be able to get, because you have to get to the end. Even if somewhere along the line you may think it's all terrible and it's for real not going to be used. So that's not the point. The point is to have the skeleton done, and not to get distracted in between by destructive thoughts. So you got to the end. Now you have your skeleton. Now the work begins, and you gently wake up your inner critic. Now at this point, your inner critic is probably quite, it's still a little sleepy, and it's quite gentle. So, and it gives you kind of friendly, good suggestions on how to, what are the next thing you can do working with this. With this piece. And as you progress, the more flesh you put on the skeleton, the more details, the more work you put in, the more ruthless your inner critic becomes. The more arrogant, the more self-confident, and rude to you. And you have to put up with it. So here where you can actually learn a lot, because your inner critic knows a lot, and it's becoming increasingly more and more aggressive towards your new piece. As your piece gets stronger and stronger, as it gains, as it becomes a real being, a real entity, your inner critic starts being more and more ruthless and aggressive towards it, and you have to listen and learn from him. At some point, your inner critic gets violent. It's going to get a large garden-sized scissors, or it's going to get a machete or a large knife, and it's going to start chopping a piece off. And be grateful if he cuts about 20%. So be grateful for that, because he can get carried away much further. At this point, he can cut off the whole piece. Hopefully it doesn't happen, but if he cuts off 20% of your masterpiece, be grateful for it, and kill your darlings. Don't save your darlings. Save your drafts so you can go back, and if at some point your inner critic really went crazy and just did some terrible mess, it can happen. You have a way to return. So save your different drafts, save your versions, but kill your darlings, because it's more important to have just the right form without anything that is extra or not necessary. And by now the inner critic is very excited, it's chopping off, it feels fully in control, so you need to know when to stop him, and when to stop editing. Because there is also such things as overpainting the painting. And what happens if you overpaint the painting, it loses some of this wonderful purity and spontaneity, this almost careless playfulness, and by playfulness I mean the part of this playful process that was at the beginning. When we create, it's important to keep this inner child alive, because children are ultimately the greatest creators. All children are creative. It is when we grow up, we stifle our creativity, we put barriers, we put doubts, limitations, and so on. So it's very important to keep this natural, effortless sense of creativity that a child has and keep it alive. Now, that's where inner critic can actually hurt your work. So you need to recognize that moment when you have to, again, turn him off. And again, the piece may not be perfect, but then nothing is perfect. And it is, you need to recognize that moment when it is as perfect as you can get it at this time in your life. You can ideally put it off for some time and then return again with a fresh perspective and again turn your inner critic and analyze it and see, well, is there truly nothing else you can do to help the piece? But it's a very sensitive relationship with our inner judgment and with a sense of strive for perfectionism, which is so important, and in a way which is the cause of why we choose art as profession. But it's also just like staring into the sun can make you blind and can hurt you. This concept of perfectionism and self-constant self-judgment can be very distractful and counterproductive in your creative life. Thank you for listening.